seated. Each year at this time, we are faced with John the Baptizer. And he's worth our attention. John was, by all accounts, a fascinating individual, fearless to a fault, spiritually generous, and loved even by the petty tyrant who had him killed to repay a drunken debt. The discovery of the ruins of an ancient religious community at Qumran in Israel and an unearthing of the Dead Sea Scrolls nearby have shed a new light on this mysterious figure. It's quite possible that John the Baptizer was at some point a member of the community known as the Essenes. The Essenes considered themselves to be a separate people, not because of external signs like skin color, but because of the illumination of their inner life and their knowledge of the hidden mysteries of nature unknown to other communities. They thought that they were the heirs of God's sons and daughters of old, the heirs to the great ancient civilization. And they worked diligently in secret for the triumph of the light over the darkness of the human mind. Now, the Dead Sea Scrolls show us a lot about their beliefs. Today, we usually think of this language of the coming kingdom as reflecting a belief in the end of the world, the end times. But in fact, that's not what they thought exactly. They use the language like the end, or the last things, or the last days. But what they mean by that is the end, the last days, of the present evil age, of the present evil age coming to an end, and in its place, the coming of a new and glorious age, a new kingdom. The Essenes differentiated between the souls which were sleeping, drowsy, and awakened. And their task, they believed, was to help, to comfort, and to relieve the sleeping souls, to try to awaken the drowsy souls, and to welcome and guide the awakened souls. They had abandoned Jerusalem, it seems, in protest against the temple and the way it was being run. And they went out into the desert to prepare the way of the Lord, following the commands, as they saw it, of the prophet Isaiah. And they go to the desert to get away from what they see to be the worldliness of Jerusalem and the worldliness of the temple. So 10 miles south of Jericho, Qumran was on a kind of dead-end street and provided a perfect location for this community to live. The way it's described geographically is that as you leave Jerusalem and go southeast toward the Dead Sea, the terrain changes rapidly. You move off gradually from rolling hillsides through the deep, narrow valleys, and the land becomes stark and desolate. It's dry, it's arid, it's rocky, and it is rough. And it is against that background of rugged cliff face on the banks of the Dead Sea, in this arid, desolate climate, that John's intellect and generosity emerge. And the first part of his speech in this morning's gospel sounds like it came straight out of that arid desert, rough and rocky Qumran. You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Well, you might ask, what in the world could possibly be considered generous about that? But then we listen to what follows. Bear fruits worthy of repentance. And then he goes on to outline how they might do that. We read about this, about John's instructions for those that he is baptizing. And that's where John might have differed from others in his own community. He actually points to the fire escape. He even has helpful things to say to tax collectors, those who despised traitors, to their own people. He has good advice that he gives to pagan soldiers who were the hated occupiers and bullies of the time. And all of it occurred in the course of his offering baptism at the Jordan River. Perhaps we're so used to associating John with baptizing that we can miss what baptism was actually meant to do. The Torah instructed followers to bathe in waters as a solution for personal contamination. Impurity was thought to be offensive to God, and occasionally Gentiles wanted to convert. And the first step in conversion was to bathe as a sign of radical change, purity in the new faith, and birth into the people of Israel. And John was baptizing Jews and pagans. Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? John's message, that false hope and security must give way to repentance and righteousness. And he warned those who sought safety in the old order and in the comfort of convention and institutions, do not begin to say we have Abraham as our father. No. Even the chosen people, those in the inner circle, must repent. And you can imagine how that must have angered those who felt they were already pure and not in need of any repentance. And so in this time of Advent, when we meet John at the river's edge and ask one another, what must we do to prepare for the coming of the kingdom? We are being shown that the repentance John calls us to is no mere change of mind and heart. It is a total metanoia, a complete turning around from self to God. It may be easy for us at this time of year to lose ourselves in these meditative blues of our churches, or throw ourselves into the other extreme of tinsel and lights and holiday rushing. But John will not compromise his message to us. He knows that when we are faced with so great and different a kingdom as this, we must turn around. We must change the direction of our hearts through deeds as costly and specific and particular as sharing the love and the light that we have been given of God to one another. Jesus is coming, God implies. Affects every dimension of our lives, including how we regard each other and our ethical obligations to one another in the world. The kingdom doesn't show up only in grand heroic deeds, but also in the simple acts of sharing what we have, being honest with one another, by working hard to resist the urge to become bullies, to be kind, tender-hearted, and gentle. We are, by acting thus, By becoming such a people as that, as this, we are ushering in the kingdom that Jesus will soon announce. And honestly, I think one of the chief ways in which we can bear witness to God's coming kingdom is to actually live like it's here now. To live like we believe it's here. To look around us with those eyes. To name the goodness. To call it out. To be grateful for it. And to realize that that truly matters and makes a difference. So it means that we have opportunities all around us to be the ordinary saints John calls us to be. And if we think our everyday actions of being honest and kind and hardworking don't matter, ask yourself this. What would it look like, honestly, if the political candidates running for president acted in that way? What about those elected leaders of ours? Our world leaders, for that matter. What about if Twitter and Facebook and Snapchat acted in that way? What would the world look like? So it's important for us to keep in mind where we're at, not just 3 weeks shy of Christmas, but living in a nation and a world constantly afraid to name that, to acknowledge that, afraid of the next terrorist crime or random act of gun violence that could happen just right around the street corner from us. And because of this fear, we change how we live at times, even risk forgetting because of that fear, forgetting who we are and whose we are. And when we do that, the terrorists win. So what might happen if we pledged that in light of this hard world, this harsh reality that we live in, what if we pledged to redouble our efforts to be kind, to be honest, to be tender-hearted, to be hardworking, meeting the needs of those around us and reaching out to help those who struggle? And in all these ways, we become witnesses to our confidence that Jesus' life, death, and resurrection make a difference. I think what would happen is that we would not only have a demonstrably better world, but we would also have a more vibrant community right here, amongst each other, whose heart beats with John's conviction that all flesh shall see the salvation of God.